If you're considering adding storage to your PC by using a PCIe card, whether your system is custom built or store bought, there's some very important steps that you should follow. And this video is just for you. Having built this computer 3 years ago for the purposes of video editing, I've now gotten to the point where I need some additional storage space. My current storage solution consisted of two PCIe cards in the system, one for data storage and the other one for the operating system. And I had two spinning drives that I ran in an array. And that was becoming a bottleneck for me, so I needed to replace this with something faster. I could go with an SD card, but I decided to go with a PCIe card because it's faster. But before rushing online to order one, I first had to open the manual. Whether your system was custom built or bought off the shelf, it came with a manual. You'll need to locate that. If it's missing, then go to the manufacturer's website to download one. If you custom built, then you want to go to the motherboard manufacturer and get their manual. What you're looking for is to see how many M.2 slots are available on your motherboard and how many are occupied at the moment. For example, in my case, I'm using M.2-1 and M.2-3, with the one being the operating system and three being storage. That leaves me with one available slot. But before I can go and just buy a memory stick for that slot, I need to know if in using that slot, I'm going to lose any SATA port lanes, because oftentimes the M.2 slot is shared with a SATA port, meaning that they're both using the same physical lane. In my case, by using the M.2 number one card, I lose SATA port 0 and SATA port 1. Because it's either one or the other. I can either use those two SATA ports and not use the M.2 one slot, or vice versa. And using the M.2 number three slot, I also lost SATA ports 4 and 5. Now, in wanting to use the M.2 two slot, I'm going to have to give up SATA port 3, which I'm currently using. Fortunately, SATA 2 port is still available. So now that you've determined that you have an available M.2 slot and that it doesn't interfere with your SATA ports, the other question you have to ask yourself is, what generation of PCIe does your motherboard support? In the case of my computer, which was built about 3 years ago, it supports Gen 3. Now, I could buy a Gen 4, which is twice as fast as a Gen 3, but my motherboard can't take advantage of that speed. Now that we know the number of available slots, what lanes are blocking what ports, and what generation PCIe I need, it's time to go online. Order your favorite computer store. I went over to crucial.com, and there you can search by the manufacturer of your computer, or if it's custom built, by the motherboard, and they'll give you a list of all the compatible storage devices that will work with it. I opted to go with a 2 terabyte PCIe 4, yes, that's right, Gen 4, and I know you're saying, wait a minute, you said your computer can only take advantage of a Generation 3. That's true, but should I upgrade my motherboard in a year or two, I'll actually be able to take advantage of the speed that's on this card. And the price difference between the 3 and 4 was so minimal that I decided to go for the 4. Once purchased, this is what you get. A box. Inside the box, we have a blister pack that contains the memory stick, a screw if you get it from Crucial, and probably a warranty card. Tools that you might need: a Phillips 0 and a Phillips number 2. Because the M.2 number 2 slot is underneath the video graphics card, I'll need to unplug it, remove the connector from the opposite end. Depending on your motherboard, there may be a clip that needs to be pressed down in order for the card to come out. With the clip release, you should be able to extract the card. And if it hangs up, then you haven't gotten that clip all the way down. You may need a long screwdriver to grab the tip of that to push it down, because it is kind of hard to get in there with your fingers. With the graphics card removed, we can see our M.2 slot, and you'll see that there are what look like little buttons all the way across, and that's where your card's going to go over. Now, depending on the length of your card, you'll need to put a mounting screw in one of these places. And you'll see that it looks orange. There's a little covering, and basically you just peel that off. And then there's a standoff usually at the end. You'll need to loosen that, place it where you want your stick to mount to, and then you'll use either the included screw that came with the card, or if you still have the original that came with your motherboard, you can use that one also. The card has a slot on one end that matches the slot on the connector. So you just align it, you push in, the card kind of springs up like a diving board. And now you'll push it down and you'll use either the screw that was included with the card or with the motherboard here to secure it. With the memory card in place, there's no heat sink. There's no heat sink for this one either. It only was included for the third one on this motherboard. Yours may be different. Just make sure it's screwed down. If you want to put a heat sink, you can. Just note that the video card is going in here, so it may get in the way. Now, before I could finish, I had to resolve the SATA port conflict that I was having with this card. So, which meant I had to lose the number 3 SATA port. So I took that cable out and I could leave the SATA port 2 in its place and I could leave these two in its place. So I gave up the SATA port that was feeding this spinning drive here, which was part of an array, so I lose the array, but it's no great loss because I have much faster storage system on the motherboard. So that's okay. So I'll just leave this drive here as just a spare. It'll just be dead, unpowered. Now I've solved the SATA port issue. We are ready to plug in the video card, connect power to it, connect it to the back of the cage, and then close up the system, and then we can power up. Upon starting the computer, if you right-click on the start menu, go to Disk Management, you should get a prompt to initialize disk. It'll say, for example, in this one it says 2. That is the drive that we installed. So now I select GPT, since it's not a boot up disk. We hit OK. And now if we look here on the disk manager, we'll see that there is 2 terabytes, disk 2, that's unallocated, meaning it needs to be formatted. So we right click on it. We want a simple volume. You hit next. Take the default, which does the entire drive. You can assign it a drive letter. We'll take G. Next, NTFS is the format. If you want to name it, you can. And I will call it Scratch Drive, as it will be used by my editing program for that purpose. We want to make sure it performs a quick format. Then we hit Next. There's a list of what it's going to do. Finish. And it's done. After closing out Disk Management and launching Explorer and looking at this PC, we see our drive, which is called Scratch Drive, 2 terabytes available, and we're ready to work. If you found this video interesting or useful, give us a thumbs up, leave us a comment, join the subscription team, and as always, thank you ever so much for watching.